Hare Krishna Gaurang Prabhu, welcome to the Monks Podcast. I've been having desire to have you invited. Many devotees who attended the Monks Podcast also they asked that we should invite you. Thank you for sparing your time today.
Thank you.
So, you know, today I thought we could discuss broadly on the topic of engaging intellectuals in our movement, and then we could focus on the BRC project for which you are one of the directors now. We could take it forward from there.
Sure.
So, you know, since my early days in Krishna consciousness, I was very inspired by how deeply you would study scripture and quote scripture and attract people. You are one of my inspirations for studying Shastra. And over the years, you know, I also appreciating how multifaceted you are, doing big projects at the same time, continuous Shastric study. And I found that there are some other devotees who like to focus more on intellectual work. And it's not so easy for them to find a space because we are a missionary movement. So over the years, different devotees try to find space in different ways. So maybe can you share your, because you're also a manager, you yourself have an intellectual nature and you also guided intellectuals. So how has your experience been in that? And then how did you eventually start getting involved with BRC?
Yeah, thank you very much, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu, for welcoming me on this podcast. And let me begin by sharing that, you know, the whole context of activities within ISKCON, International Society for Krishna Consciousness, is in the context of bhakti or devotional service. And the very definition of pure devotional service as described by Srila Rupa Goswami is anyabhilashita shunyam jnana karmadi anavratam anukulena anushidanam bhaktir uttam.
Yes.
Anukulena Krishna anushilanam bhaktir uttam. So the main idea is devotion is all about service. Pure devotion means service without other considerations. And pure devotional service is about serving and pleasing Krishna without any other personal considerations. And therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna brings in the topic of a graded elevation of our consciousness at whatever level one may be, and then how yoga is all about using the elements of action, knowledge, renunciation, meditation, and devotion. And to the extent a particular component of each of these elements is in majority, then that particular means or medium of connectivity is known by that name. Like, for example, if action is the predominant element or the means and instrument by which we are connecting with the Supreme, then that is known as the Karma Yoga. If knowledge is the more prominent and predominant, then it is known as Jnana Yoga. Similarly, meditation and renunciation is more predominant, it's called Ashtanga Yoga. And then devotional service is all about how we can engage all of our desires to match with the desires of Krishna. And therefore, when we speak about intellectual approach, then basically one of the most sophisticated literatures written by Srila Vyasadeva is Srimad Bhagavatam, because the original intellectual is Vyasadeva, who is the literary incarnation of Krishna himself. So therefore, if you're looking for, you know, your ideal intellectual or the intellectual who is to be your hero, then I don't see anyone better than Vyasadeva, who can be the hero for the aspiring intellectuals. And the interesting twist in Vyasadeva's story is after having accomplished a rare or a never before seen or may never again be repeated intellectual feat of completing the four Vedas, the 108 Upanishads, the 18 Puranas, and all the various other literatures connected to that, including the Vedanta Sutra, he was still sitting dissatisfied. Mm-hmm. And then his guru, Srila Narad Muni, came, and then he asked him, why are you dissatisfied? And then Vyasadeva said, well, I just followed all your orders. I did all these compositions, but still I am dissatisfied. Mm-hmm. And at that time, Srila Narad Muni explained to him that you are dissatisfied because you have not completely glorified Krishna to the extent you should have, and explained your devotional service the way it should be very clearly explained. So therefore, one of our acharyas explains, Ananda Mayo Abhyasat, which is a Vedanta Sutra aphorism, which also means that unless there is repetition of the names and the forms and the glories of Krishna, it does not really invoke true pleasure within the heart. And therefore, Srila Prabhupada, the founder of ISKCON, went to the West carrying the first three volumes of the first canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And his idea was to create a spiritual revolution in the lives of the misdirected civilization of this world. So the idea is that, yes, there may be a manual. The manual may be written in a very intellectually stimulating manner. And there are two choices we have: to get absorbed in the language and the intellectual rigor of the manual, or to actually use the manual to do what it is supposed to do or intended for. And therefore, as intellectuals who are practicing devotional service, we have to be alert to the fact that we have to be careful to use the manual for the particular purpose for which it has been written, and not get absorbed in enjoying the intellectual variety within the manual.
This brilliant, like, for example, brilliant example. It recipe illustrates the pitfall of how we might use the very thing that is meant to take us to Krishna to actually stay away from Krishna, in a sense, or to not go toward Krishna. Amazing. Exactly.
So basically, the idea is that if there may be a recipe book. So there are two people. I can give an example of two people. One person memorizes the entire recipe book. And you ask him any recipe, he can tell verbatim. You take this, mix this, do that, including the quantities, numbers, everything is by heart. And he really loves repeating the recipe book. And he really impresses people by his thorough knowledge of the recipe book. And then there is a second person who doesn't really go beyond the first recipe, which is plain rice. But he understands the recipe of the plain rice, goes to the kitchen and cooks, plain rice for four people. So in one sense, who's fulfilling the objective of the recipe book? The first person has memorized it thoroughly, and he can even tell you visually which pictures on which page of the recipe book look better than the others. And the second one has not gone beyond the first page, but he has actually understood the first recipe well and is able to do the needful to remove his hunger and others' hunger. So therefore, that's the context of devotional service and understanding all these tools which are required for us to become better servants.
Okay. So overall, if any devotees who are walking to work in an intellectual field, the primary is the service attitude. The secondary is whatever particular propensity they have, they can engage it. So intellectual is a propensity. Thank you. Yes, Prabhu. So keeping this in mind,
We also had traditionally Varanashram where Brahmanas were engaged in a Brahminical way, Kshatriyas were engaged in a Kshatriya way. So we keep Krishna as the purpose, but then we look at our nature also and engage ourselves accordingly. So when I started getting introduced, I found writing as a way of expressing myself. And through that, I was able to engage my intellectual nature. And then when I travel abroad also, at some places, more than others, then we have people who are significantly more intellectually oriented. At the same time, we as a movement are in some ways reaching out to people who are already religiously or spiritually inclined. We are not really reaching out to people who are serious intellectuals. So one way why I say this is that I'm an editor of BTG and I also try to encourage devotees to write. And I don't see many devotees who are, many devotees are intelligent, no doubt, but not many devotees are intellectual, or many people who are intellectual, very articulate in writing, very deep in insights. Somehow we are not able to attract them. So one reason I thought is that, I thought of three main reasons for this. One is often we go to the, our main outreach in university is to the engineering colleges. And there it's people who are more have technical rather than the kind of analytical intelligence that is required, say, in humanities and other things. So we are reaching out to people who are technically intelligent, not like social intellectuals. Second reason I felt is that our mode of outreach, not just whom we are reaching, our mode of outreach is also a little too didactic. This is right, this is wrong. And sometimes thoughtful people require a little more patience to start understanding and accepting things. And thirdly, which I feel is even if people come through, they often feel I don't have enough engagement over here. So for devotees to have a facility for intellectually inclined devotees to have a facility for intellectual engagement within our movement, there is not that much infrastructure available. So many first generation Prabhupada disciples whom I have talked with who are now at established positions in academia, they told me that most of them were brahmacharis earlier. They were like everybody in the past moved into temple. They told me that they didn't see much growth prospect for themselves as brahmacharis, especially growth in terms of intellectual growth. And they went toward academic studies. So in that sense, they created a space for themselves. And I think in overall Hinduism studies, we have a significant number of Gaudiya Vaishnava scholars now. It's more as compared to the size of Gaudiya Vaishnavism within Hinduism, the number of Gaudiya Vaishnava academic scholars are significantly more. So we have created an impact there. And they are, most of them are appreciative of the movement. At the same time, something within our movement, we don't have that much space for people to get engaged. So any thoughts on this?
I think I have a few preliminary thoughts to put things in context.
Yes.
As soon as we begin discussion on, you know, intellectual and academic engagement, I think let me preface whatever I'm going to say by first clarifying that, you know, those who are hearing, they should not automatically assume that intellectual means superior.
Of course.
Because sometimes some kind of connotation some people may come to. And basically, it's one of the tracks in which a person can feel engaged and absorb them. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself, he was one of the topmost intellectuals of his times at Navdeep. He was the supreme scholar of all kinds of Nyaya Shastras, and he was known as Nimai Pandit.
Yes.
And then, you know, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, at one point of time when he met his spiritual master, Srila Ishwarapuri. Then he, as part of his pastime and leela, he became really transformed and absorbed in serving. Mm-hmm. And he used his intellectual background and his assets in devotional service perfectly by helping transform some of the most significant scholars of that time.
Yes.
Like Sarabhaum Bhattacharya and Prakash Ananda Saraswati. And, you know, using his intellectual acumen, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu presented the conclusions of the scriptures in terms of the Vaishnava context to all of them and transformed them. So when we look at, you know, the modern day academia, the way things are set up today, different religious organizations, whether they are Buddhists or Christian or Muslim or Hindu. So we have to find a method by which some people who are inspired by the individual teachings of these different religious texts, then they find a way by which they can engage with the secular academic world.
Mm.
And that is how the whole academic, you know, setup is. Because by definition, if you're part of the academia, then you cannot be officially or directly be aligned with one particular thought process, because the whole idea of academic approach is to question and, you know, be in the process of evolving your thought process.
Yes.
On a regular basis.
It's,
yeah,
called critical scholarship.
Exactly.
So one of the best statements I noticed that the difference between, say, the academic approach and traditional approach is the traditional approach to study of scripture begins with faith.
Right.
Whereas the academic approach begins with doubt.
Right.
If it passes doubt, okay, I'll accept it. But the default attitude is doubt. Yeah, it's a very different paradigm. Now,
yes,
just to contextualize this, I read a scrapbook of Srila Prabhupada. Of Sadaput Prabhu with Prabhupada, that is first meeting about the Bhaktivedanta Institute. And now Prabhupada wanted Bhaktivedanta Institute not just for scientific outreach, but for, in general, scholarly outreach. And right, he said, there are four target audiences over there. He said, we should make presentations for scholars. Mm. Then secondly, for the general educated people. Third is for students who will probably become scholars or become a part of general educated students. And fourth is for devotees who are inclined in this direction so that they can become future members of the Bhaktivedanta Institute.
Fantastic.
So it's very, very good at all frame. So I think intellectual engagement can work in all four ways. One is,
definitely,
of course, academic outreach. And now, with respect to, just to take a case study, you know, atheism is becoming very influential in the West.
Mm-hmm.
And one reason for that is there is what is a whole genre of writing called popular science.
Mm-hmm.
Also, some scientists, they may not be very, very big scientists, but they are science popularizers. They take scientific concepts, maybe atheistic scientific concepts, and write for a mass audience. So intellectual engagement doesn't have to be just writing for the academia, but even writing intellectually for the general educated readers.
Yes.
So those four I added. Yes, from.
Yeah, I think you do that very well, which you just, what you just described.
I try to in my small way. Yes, true. Thank you.
So basically, you know, as I just described that, and you rightly said that currently out of the 7.6 billion population on the planet, 31% are Christians, 23% Muslims. Interestingly, 16% are described as atheist, agnostic, non-believer, skeptics, or whatever.
Mm.
15% of the world population is Hindu, and around 7.5 to 8% is Buddhists. So, as far as we are concerned, at the Bhaktivedanta Research Center, our greatest effort is how we can try to establish religious studies within India. So okay. As you know that in 1962-63 American Academy of Religion was established. And so it was accepted that you can approach religion either through the, you know, emotional mass appeal manner by visiting the churches and the synagogues and temples and all. The second is you can also approach religion in an academic way, and specifically, you know, those who are intellectuals may want to approach it that way. And therefore, an excellent facility was created through the AAR. And today they have more than 10,000 scholars, and they meet every year and have large gatherings in huge cities where they have these conferences. And I would say that way back in the 1970s, you know, the Honorable Dalai Lama, he took a very strategic step and inspired people to actually go into Buddhist scholarship. And like, for example, Dr. Robert Thurman was one of the first, one of the pioneers who actually established, you know, Buddhist studies in a major way. And now so many Buddhist scholars have been created. And as you rightly said that, you know, the Oxford Center for Hindu Studies pioneered by Shaunak Rishi Prabhu, they have done excellent groundwork in creating such a fantastic array of scholars over the last 2.5 decades. So I think such initiatives are laudable, amazing. And with the new education policy being rolled out by the Government of India recently, I think there are tremendous opportunities for integrating traditional wisdom with the modern technical and other education, and especially the technical education and the management education has found its place in India in a big way. But I do not think that India has come anywhere close to study and creating the study of liberal arts the way they have accomplished in the West. And what we know as liberal arts today was traditionally in India part of, you know, understanding the entire gamut of languages, literatures, especially connected with Sanskrit. And all of that was described in great detail. But with the breakdown of our traditional education system, thanks to the intervention by Macaulay, we have kind of lost touch with our traditional education system. And so we are kind of in a confused state, neither here nor there. So I think that's an arena which we need to really deal with. And I think ISKCON, with its vast talent pool globally and with a very vast number of intellectuals and intellectually inclined people, they have a major role to play, because today in India we have around 27 crore or 270 million students in the first to 12th standard, around 300 million or 3.5 million or 3 crores or what do you call that, you know, 30 million people in the college system. But the challenge is that majority of them are the many majority of them who are at the top of the intellectual niche, they actually take to either engineering or accountancy, or they go for the professional courses.
Yes.
And what we know in India as, you know, Bachelor of Arts or even language studies or whatever, those kind of courses are taken up by those who cannot get into any of those colleges. Exactly. So many times we find that in many of these Bachelors of Arts or Masters of Arts courses, the ones who are taking to those courses are not the ones taking by choice, but it is because of circumstances because of which they are there. So overall, then the quality of the intellectual pool which we are landing up with within these genres is of a different kind. Whereas one advantage we find with many of the spiritual organizations like ISKCON and many others is that many of these spiritual organizations of different denominations, and let me just focus specifically with the context of India because I have more experience here, that all of these organizations, whether they are traditional or new age or whatever, all these spiritual organizations are attracting all kinds of talented people, and especially from the corporates, very successful people who have made their money and have settled down and are looking for now purpose. So as what Maslow calls it, the self-actualization, they're looking for some kind of fulfillment and direction. And therefore, if religious studies as a field is given priority in India, and secularism as it is known now is redefined in a whole new healthy manner, then it will give a lot of opportunities for many of such people who are in their 30s and 40s to also connect with a religion and spirituality in a more intellectually engaging manner than what, opportunities they have presently. So that with approximately 65,000 colleges and universities which we have across India, which all have, certain basic courses very readily available, if all of those institutions also have a parallel school of religious studies where people, while they are studying, they could always take, some kind of course, an audit course or an introductory course, or get introduced to those courses. So they have some idea as per their interest to get connected with, and those who are already in their career track and with their families, they can always have an option of, joining in as part of their adult education program, in person, in class, or online. So the varieties of offerings which spirituality and religious studies could actually lend is innumerable. And at the same time, it could create a complete transformation in people's character and value systems, with the real the reality being that 2,000 crore rupees, almost you would say that $1/3 of a billion of drugs is being smuggled into India every single day. And that's specifically targeted towards, the habits of the youth. And when people just do not have the sufficient strength to say no to their temptations, then they become victims to all kinds of habits. And we have, people across the world struggling with addictions. 1 billion smoking addicts across the world are struggling with the habits of smoking. And therefore, especially in the pandemic, we see that, yes, after IQ, after EQ, after SQ, now we really have to take AQ, or adversity quotient, very seriously on how we develop capabilities within people to develop their strength to be able to deal with adversities and adversities. So I think there are a lot of opportunities.
So amazingly big picture. Thank you. Yeah, this is amazingly huge picture that, say, what you're saying is that people could approach religion itself in two different ways. One is traditionally by going to temples, also academically by going to get degrees. And that facility is there in America, but that's not there much in India. In fact, hardly anything at all. I was talking with one devotee, or one ISKCON sannyasi guru. So one of his disciples wanted to do a religious studies degree, and he was going to go into engineering and masters. So when he said this to his parents, his mother's reaction was almost like her son wants to become a brahmachari. She said, if you do that, I will commit suicide. So it seems that is not at all considered a viable path. So that could be a big change. And I think we as a movement will have to work with the government, and that will require a huge effort to actually do it. So religious studies, as you rightly said, because of the distorted or unclear definition of secularism, religious studies is not much possible at this stage. You have to go through something like sociology or philosophy or something like that, some other channels. So now within this big picture, how does BRC fit in, or say create scope for religious studies? How is BRC, how are we going ahead in that?
Yeah, Srila Prabhupada actually mentions, you know, in one of his quotes, treat this matter very seriously and thoroughly and take all precautions to protect these Vedic literatures. And Srila Prabhupada was very much wanting that ISKCON be at the forefront of having systematic spiritual knowledge being disseminated. So as at the Bhaktivedanta Research Center, we are now running courses in 8 cities, including Mumbai, Pune, Thane, Kolkata, Vrindavan, etc. And the Bhaktivedanta Research Center in Mumbai is affiliated to the University of Mumbai, Mumbai University, in 2014. So we are an accredited, affiliated research center. So we can give MA and PhD programs, and we can also run diploma and certificate programs. And basically, we are trying to facilitate the study and research of ancient Indian philosophy, arts, and sciences. But then many people say, what is the point of, you know, going back into tradition? Today is the day of technology. So yes, can tradition be married seamlessly with technology? So therefore, by having intelligent people do bona fide research, we are trying to find contemporary applied solution in, you know, 5 areas. First is ethics, applied solutions in ethics, applied solutions for people in emotions, applied solutions in environment, applied solutions in entrepreneurship, applied solutions in improving efficiency.
Oh, that's very contemporary.
Very we smart. Find that, you know, one of the greatest challenges people face today is, for just to give an example of efficiency. So if a person has all the capabilities, he has the best skill, but his mind is overwhelmed with worry. And there was a report many years ago in UK that, you know, the 3 biggest challenges the Indian community in United Kingdom is facing, especially London, is, you know, and, you know, they found that the maximum percentage of cardiovascular diseases was found amongst the Indian community at that particular point in time. And so the report said that 3 reasons for such high incidence of heart disease. First, they said, was curry, which was, you know, the cuisine, which was very heavy with oil and other things. First was curry. Second was hurry, that we're trying to do too many things, you know, and not having a proper schedule. So first was curry, second was hurry, and third was worry. And worry is something which, as you know, that across the world, 300 million people are experiencing disorders connected to anxiety. And you write a lot about those things. But it affects efficiency. And we find that Arjuna, one of the most efficient of all sharpshooters, was right there with all of his skills at his disposal. But suddenly the situation he found himself in completely paralyzed his efficiency. So he had the skill, but he lost the will. And therefore, you know, ethics, emotions, environment, entrepreneurship, and efficiency, who can say that these are not relevant topics? And if our research in ancient wisdom can help the modern, you know, housewife or the corporate or the student improve in any of these 5 areas, why not?
Yes, this is. So when we are, say, focusing on these 5 areas, is it like we are having devotees do some studies to do some PhD over there? Or are we getting academic scholars to study these books and come up with these paradigms, or how are we approaching this right now?
See, currently academic scholars across the world are anyway working on these and, you know, coming up with research topics and everything.
Okay.
But we are specifically within Bhaktivedanta Research Center focused on not just, you know, we are not saying that, you know, we have only practicing devotees who should do this or something like that. the Bhaktivedanta Research Center, just like the Oxford Center for Hindu Studies, is a center which is dedicated to see how high-class, world-class academic research can happen in the area of Vaishnavism.
Okay.
So it could be anybody from anywhere across the globe. You know, the access to do research in Vaishnavism specifically and philosophy generally is open to all. So the whole idea of Bhaktivedanta Research Center is that we are affiliated to Mumbai University within the philosophy department. And specifically, we specialize in being a library which preserves the Vaishnav literature and the great treasure house of the Vaishnav lore.
Okay. Like that. So this is basically for anyone who is interested, devotees who are intellectually inclined, as well as those who are non-practitioners who may be interested in subject. This is basically like any, you could say, university department or university research center that people can come, but it's a special focus. That's wonderful. You know, with respect to how a tradition interacts with the contemporary environment, with the contemporary world, there are four modalities, they say. There is insider-insider, insider-outsider, outsider-insider, and outsider-outsider. So insider-insider is, say, like our Bhagavatam classes or our Bhakti Shastri. Somebody already is practicing. So for intellectuals, the way I think of engagement, some intellectual devotees become satisfied in insider-insider engagement. So they may become systematic teachers of Shastra, or they may translate some books which are primarily meant for devotees. So insider-insider is one modality. Then insider-outsider is primarily what we call as outreach. So that can be done at a normal level where people come to us, to our forums. They come to our temples, our websites. They read our books. And there is some way to reach that. And in that, I feel there's not much scope for intellectual outreach. But it is primarily it's outsider-outsider means a devotee gets a place in an outsider forum. Like a devotee gets to write a newspaper, a devotee's book is published by a mainstream publisher, a devotee becomes a faculty in a mainstream university, or forums which are arranged by outsiders, and there we get to present. So there we get some training for that. That's outsider-outsider. And then the outsider-insider is where we learn from outsiders, maybe certain ways of analyzing things, what they think about our tradition, and then we engage in dialogue. So from what I can see, in some ways, BRC is facilitating all these four things. You have the Bhagavat Vidyapita, which is like an insider to insider, training serious Bhagavatam overview and study. And then there is insider-outsider through all these ethics and emotions. These can reach you a broader audience also. And then if devotees become well-trained academically, they can also go into outsider-outsider. So broadly, if some devotees today want to join, so is it that it's like normally applying for a university? It's a normal way to apply like that and take it forward from there?
Well, at this stage, we have become active with the MA and PhD program primarily in Mumbai. And then the Mumbai University norms allow a few, people to get registered in the first phase, depending on the number of guides we have and things like that.
Okay.
So therefore, at this stage, we have a few people who are registered with us for PhD, and they are taking this forward. And a few people who have also registered for the master's program. And generally speaking, what we also have is we have different scholars from different parts of the world who are also like the additional guides who conduct once or twice in a year, they conduct courses and coursework for such students. So at this stage, I think, we have not yet gone beyond Mumbai in terms of MA and PhD program. But hopefully, moving forward, very soon we'll be opening up in Pune, in Kolkata, and in Vrindavan also, these programs where gradually many other people can get connected and affiliated. So at this stage, I would not say that we have vacancies available and create hopes amongst people. But we are just trying out with a few people to make sure that we are actually able to get the model correct, because ultimately we want to make sure that whoever does get registered and follows up this particular activity does it with high degree of quality.
Yes, that's true.
So therefore, once, you know, I would say that, the best way we would share the news about this more would be through successfully, you know, completed coursework of candidates who have done this program well. And then, you know, the quality of their scholarship should speak for itself.
Yeah.
So scholarship is not something which can be done in a haphazard manner or in a shortcut manner.
That's true.
And it has to be done thoroughly and properly. So we are very happy to have a good team of guides who are extremely diligent and who do not, you know, compromise at all with respect to quality. So therefore, there is a certain quality benchmark which has been set, and then whoever can match that goes forward, and whoever will not be able to match that then, you know, tries again, and that's how this entire program will function.
Okay. Yeah, I saw the report you have of the last year's activities. It's impressive, and I'll share this in the YouTube description here.
Yes, definitely. Sure.
So it's I think you got a elite set of scholars who are already quite respected. They have very good publications in the mainstream academy in the West. And also all of them are sympathetic to the tradition. Either they are practitioners or they are supportive. So in that sense, they can also, it is not like a big jolt for some people who come from within the devotional world to study the academic way of restudying. It can be actually quite challenging for one's faith to suddenly adopt a critical approach to study. So overall, I think it's a very good setup we have for a pilot stage project right now. So
right.
One major challenge, whenever I talk with people who want to get into academic studies or do some kind of academic project, is the financial sustainability. First of all, to run the project itself, and then for the graduates who do it, how the engagements for them, for which they can sustain themselves. So how are we addressing it at this at present?
At present, we only have students who are already engaged in the regular profession, because all said and done, even till today, the reality is that education is equal to employment, especially in India.
Yes.
So therefore, we are only connecting with people who are already employed, engaged, and a few monks who are interested to do this. Okay. So as far as and our guides and international guides are also those who do not need any major financial remuneration on an ongoing basis from us. Okay. But they are happy to affiliate. So we do have you know, very willing donors who are willing to support this cause, because throughout history education has always been supported and funded by the governments and by the wealthy. And so even the top Ivy school institutions in America, many of them began as theological institutions only. And even in India, typically you will find that the last temple town which was ransacked by Muhammad Ghazni was basically in Somnath, and then Varanasi, Vrindavan. And then the six Goswamis and Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu rebuilt Vrindavan, you know. So basically, temple towns as a concept has been almost become extinct in India. Whereas previously they were the main centers for not just learning, but along with learning also trade, commerce, and all kinds of other powerful exchanges. And so we find that when there was royal patronage, the scholars could flourish, scholarship could flourish, and the whole society would benefit from it. And if today, in today's context, if you see that amongst the academic institutions, Harvard has one of the largest endowment funds in the whole world. Okay. And the reason being that, you know, when people see very good quality intellectual work happening, then those with wealth are willing to support it. So if we are able to create a framework for very high quality intellectual work and support the entire society in those five areas, as I just described, you know, so then why would people not want to support? Because ultimately wealth is created when you solve some real problems which society is facing. And only thing is people at this stage have not understood, at least, you know, within the Hindu society, I would say, the value of financially supporting intellectual work in our traditional wisdom. Hindus Yes. are very, very generous in supporting creation of temples. They are very supportive of creation of large complexes where deities are worshipped, and there is a lot of emotional appeal connected with that. And I think that's wonderful. Along with that, we need to create a culture where favorable, you know, wealthy patrons come forward to support intellectual work connected to our Vedic wisdom. So yes. that's, I think, very important. So Srila Prabhupada's desire for establishing an academic research institute offering PhD degrees and affiliating with Calcutta University is something which I want to read out from a Vyas Puja offering by Ravindra Swarup Prabhu.
You can share it like, so that people can also see it while you're reading it. Yeah, if you want, I'll or you can just...
Yeah. I'll share it on the screen. Are you able to see?
Yes, clearly.
Yeah. So basically here he says, from the Vyas Puja offering 2019 by Ravindra Swarup Prabhu, during the 1976 Gaur Purnima festival, I was summoned by your servant, Kamal Krishna Maharaj. Srila Prabhupada wants to talk to you. He brought me to you and placed before a plan, Sridhar Mayapur, what you call as ISKCON Bhagwat College. You also told Kamal Krishna Maharaj to compile a list of ISKCON devotees in the West who already had undergraduate degrees. From these would come the students at ISKCON Bhagwat College. The faculty would be composed of me and others who had a PhD. Then you instructed me to go to University of Calcutta and confer with the proper authorities about affiliating ISKCON Bhagwat College with that institution. As it became clear as we talked that what you wanted in Mayapur was a degree granting graduate research institute. You told me that students at our ISKCON Bhagwat College prepare their dissertations under our direction, and that the University of Calcutta would give the final exam and award the degree, and that degree you announced would be PhDB, Doctor of Bhagwat Philosophy.
Beautiful.
So I thought, you know, people would appreciate seeing one such quote amongst hundreds of quotes which Prabhupada has actually shared in this video.
So it's remarkable how multifaceted Prabhupada's vision was. So not just directed like building temples and distributing books, but also establishing university and creating degrees for studying Bhagavad. Beautiful. You know, one of the exciting things I noticed in the newsletter was the exploration of the possibility of Prabhupada University. Would right. you like to speak something about that? Or were you saying something more? You want to complete that?
Yeah. So basically, you know, considering Srila Prabhupada's focus on connection with Kolkata, His Grace Harishori Prabhu and Pranava Prabhu 29th of June 2009, they began the Bhaktivedanta Research Center as a library. And this library consists of more than 20,000 books. And this has the personal collection of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, which is known as the Sundarananda Vidya Vinod connection also. This has more than 3,000 books, this particular collection.
Okay.
And, you know, the books have been categorized into 14 different categories. The four Vaishnava Sampradayas, then the Harinam, the Dham, Hari Bhajan, Hari Bhaktagan, the Vedas and Vedanta Sutra, Upanishads, the Puranas, the Dharma Shastras, the Bhagavad Gita, the Vishwakosha, the Bhagavatam, then the, you know, what do you call as the grammar or Vyakarana, books of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, books of the Goswami, Acharyas, we have books of Srila Rupa Goswami, Jiva Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, we have from Baladeva Vidya Bhushan, Rai Ramanandan, Arhari Chakravarti, Narottam Das Thakur, Prabodhanand Saraswati, Kaviraj Goswami. So, and then we have, apart from this Sundarananda Vidya Vinod collection, we have various manuscripts and copies of Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, Ramayana, Mahabharata, Brahma Sutras, Upanishads, Vedas, cosmology, many, many books connected to the Indic religions, philosophy and culture. So we have a manuscripts mission which goes out to all the different villages and places across and try to get the either the original manuscripts or digitized copies. So, you know, nearly 1500 manuscripts have been digitized and we have gathered information of more than 3000 manuscripts and, you know, various remote places, people are having this wealth, but they just do not know what to do with it. And therefore, it's very important that if any of the viewers or hearers of this podcast, if they have access to any such manuscripts or they feel that they can connect us with such manuscripts, and our team would be more than happy and willing to reach out and get these manuscripts or digitize them. And it's there on our brcindia.com website. You could have a look at all of the manuscripts digitized so far. And we have what is known as the Bhaktivedanta Research Center BRC Library Organization and Digitization Project, which started in 2018. And over the last 2 years, out of 20,000, 3,000 books have been completed. And this is a very important, you know, thing. And for those of you who are not aware that in the 50s and 60s, many of the manuscripts from India, they were sent to American libraries. And many of the original manuscripts are there in the American libraries. And we also have started a project called BRC New York, where we want to actually digitize many of those manuscripts and then also have a copy with us. And this year we are very excited to share with all our viewers, those who are attending your podcast, that we have some significant projects going on, especially Thakur Bhaktivinod's autobiography is being worked upon, which is known as the Swalikhita Jeevani Project, which is the only autobiography of a Gaudiya Vaishnava Acharya. And this has many details about how he grew up and things like that. It was written in the form of a letter to his son. Mm-hmm. And we have, you know, scholars like Dr. Shantanu De, Dr. Abhishek Ghosh, who are actually leading this project. And basically the translation, almost 60% has been done. And then various historical contextualizing of the words, personalities and places with annotations that will happen after that. And then there will be a chronological timeline of events of Thakur Bhaktivinoda's life. And this was written in 1896. And so a postscript of the remaining 14 years of his life after 1896 will also be documented. And there is an idea to form a database of scholarly writings on Thakur Bhaktivinoda. Mm-hmm. So there will be other contributions also from the scholars in the community. And so this is planned to be launched sometime next year, Krishna willing, depending on how things progress. The BRC team of scholars is also working on one Ultradanga Junction, where, as you know, that ISKCON has now the property, and sometime next year that property will be renovated and opened as a museum and a cultural house for the whole world to come and see the exact spot where His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada, as Abhay Charan Day, received instruction from his guru Srila Saraswati Thakur that you should go and preach in the English language all over the world. As they say that it was a word which transformed everything. And therefore, the entire research on the Ultradanga Junction is happening with a group of scholars led by Dr. Ferdinando and various senior Vaishnavas of those times are being interviewed. Sundar Gopal Prabhu is one of the staff at the BRC, is very actively involved. And so various other museum projects related to that are envisaged. And there is a Maharas Manjusha research project, a poetic rendition of from the 16th century Srinagi temple tradition of Braja from the Vallabh Sampradaya. So that is happening. And a lot of powerful research work is being conducted, which is being led by Dr. David Heberman. And Dr. David Heberman and Sri Manoj Goswami and Prakriti Goswami, they are the leading this project. So, as I said, the BRC is not restricted to just only Gaudiya Vaishnavism, but across any kinds of academic activities which interface with philosophy and religion. Another interesting project is the Vaishnava Encyclopedia Project, where there is a work known as Gaudiya Vaishnava Abhidhan, which is a multi-volume encyclopedic work which has been published by Haridas Das. And, you know, Saraswati Thakur writes in his will that, you know, something related to this with respect to the Vaishnava encyclopedia of a different type was being, at that point, handled by the Gaudiya Math at that time. It was very close to his heart. And therefore, this is a very important project which is being led by a group of scholars. They're regularly meeting and working on this. And I think in another couple of years' time, this one will be actually released. A lot of work field trips are involved, and future plans of this project is also to connect this with some kind of holy places of pilgrimage and tourism, which is related to spiritual pilgrimage spots. And then another project which is being conducted is understanding the context of counseling, philosophical counseling, because as the COVID has hit across the world, many people are going through anxiety syndromes and difficulties coping with change. So philosophical counseling with special reference to Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam, which has hundreds and thousands of episodes of exchanges happening between someone who's distressed due to a particular situation and finding shelter in a philosophical discussion and dialogue, and how we can find all of these ancient philosophical dialogues which were spoken to relieve people of their current distress be applicable in today's context. So that is another exciting project being taken up. And another very interesting project is the Bhagavat traditions in Maharashtra, because across Maharashtra, different scholars, different saints at different times have approached Bhagavatam, interpreted Bhagavatam, and explored Bhagavatam in different ways. And so Dr. Ravi Gupta, Dr. Shakuntala Gaude, Dr. Sumanta, Deen Gauranga Das from ISKCON Chopadi are very much involved in trying to explore this Bhagavat traditions in Maharashtra. And in this way, you know, all of these exciting research projects are happening, which create a plethora of opportunities for intellectually inclined devotees who are grounded in the basic idea of Vaishnavism, of being a Das, Dasa, Das. And once we are grounded in the right frame of mind with the right attitude, then the amount of intellectual exploration which is possible for self-transformation and for transforming society is limitless.
Amazing. It's the university is only, Bhakti Research Center, where we are giving degrees is only one part of it. In a sense, you are doing a lot more than that. creating museums, preserving books. And it's sometimes, this is also what you said, is sometimes we are seen as a little bit of an exclusivist kind of organization where we care only for ourselves. But here we are creating a project which is taking people to, which is engaging with the Bhagavad tradition in general, with somebody, with a scholar from, a poet from outside tradition also. I mean, from the Pushti Marg also. Maharaj, this is wonderful. So would you like to speak a few concluding words about the Prabhupada University? Because that is something which I read about, or it's in a nascent stage right now. And just...
You can also share the link to a recent Facebook Live conversation I had with Dr. Vijay Bhatkar.
Yes, I saw that.
The founder of the India's Param Computer Project.
Yes.
Very, very noted educationist and a leading scientist. One of the chief advisors to the Prime Minister on scientific matters, and also with Dr. Bhushan Patwardhan, who was also kind enough to be part of that conversation, who is the Vice Chairman of the UGC, University Grants Commission. And we have discussed a lot on this subject, the essential point being that we need to approach education not just from the perspective of something which can help create career, but also how it can add to the component of character and create a holistic personality for students. So we aspire to create students who are trained not just to solve problems in paper, but who can actually solve problems in their own life. And with that perspective, the conversation is there. That's pretty exciting. And as you said, that it is still in the process of discussion. As you know, that it is creating a huge institution with the terrific responsibilities attended to it. So it will take some time before we are actually able to understand the whole gamut of activities involved. And then when you know, things appear positive, then you may hear something more from us.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your time, Prabhu. Wonderful. Very enlivening to see so many universe of outreach and opportunities opening up. And we'll keep, I mean, hopefully as things move forward, we'll have you again and we can have further discussions. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, Chaitanya Charan Prabhu, for inspiring the whole world with your amazing ocean of transcendental wisdom and so many books and podcasts and presentations you are making, which really is very enlivening and enlightening to the whole world. We are very grateful to you, and I wish and pray that you continue your amazing efforts. Thank you.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.